Hello, everyone, and welcome to Advising for Future Ready Careers. My name is Kelsey Kamen, and I am the program coordinator for NCWIT's Counselors for Computing. It's my pleasure to bring you the fourth episode of this six-part series hosted by NCWIT Counselors for Computing. Each month through July, we will be connecting you with thought leaders at the cutting edge of technology. This series offers a unique opportunity to dive into the intersection of computer science with traditional and non-traditional STEM fields, also known as CS plus X. Throughout the presentation, we would love for you to submit questions through the Q&A feature on the toolbar at the bottom of your screen. The National Center for Women in Information Technology, or NCWIT, is a nonprofit community of more than 1,400 universities, companies, nonprofits, and government organizations nationwide. NCWIT equips change leaders with resources for taking action in recruiting, retaining, and advancing women across the entire computing ecosystem. Before NCWIT, programs focusing on women and computing existed mostly in isolation, without the benefit of shared best practices, effective resources, communication with others, or national reach. Today, these programs are part of the NCWIT community, creating a far greater impact than if institutions acted alone. Counselors for Computing, C4C, is one of the programs in the NCWIT K-12 Alliance. NCWIT C4C program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. We bring people and programs together with professional development, knowledge, and resources to give all students access to transformative computing careers. And we wouldn't be here today without the support of our sponsor, the Department of Defense STEM, the largest employer of scientists and engineers in the nation. DoD STEM offers educational programs, internships and scholarships for students, and many career development opportunities for educators. We shared their website in the chat for you to learn more. And I would now like to introduce our guest speakers today, Ruth and Tom Kyle. Ruth has been a school counselor for over 17 years at all levels from pre-K through high school, as well as having experience in an adolescent residential treatment center. She holds both a bachelor and master's degree in music education from Southeastern University in Durant, Oklahoma, and continued with her master's degree in school counseling from East Central University in Ada, Oklahoma. Education administration from Lamar University, and hours to complete her LPC at University of Texas Permian Basin. I got it. She's currently an LPC intern under the supervision of Dr. Jay Maxwell. Ruth is a Counselors for Computing consultant who is a cheerleader for how computer science is applicable to every possible career pathway and degree plan, and in particular encourages females of color and those who feel they can't do computer science to give it a try. Tom has been a public school teacher since 2013. He also has 10 years teaching experience at the post-secondary level. He has a bachelor's degree in computer science from ECU in Ada, Oklahoma, and an MBA from the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. Prior to teaching, he worked primarily as a computer programmer, analyst, and project manager for many years. He's held many tech jobs from PC tech to chief information officer. He's passionate about teaching computer science in particular, and looks forward to sharing his knowledge and experience in the real world with the next generations. He has sponsored campus clubs for cybersecurity, computer science, robotics, web design, and chess. In 2019, Tom won the We Teach CS Changemaker Award. Tom is particularly proud that most of his clubs had members from female and underrepresented minority populations. So thank you, Tom and Ruth. We're looking forward to this presentation. In this presentation, you will hear from two of Ruth and Tom's high school students, as well as from Minakashi and Aether, two postgraduate students, as they discuss their journey navigating higher education and the workforce with disabilities. So please enjoy this presentation and ask questions throughout by using the Q&A feature at the bottom of the Zoom toolbar. Enjoy.
Hello, my name is Ruth Kyle, a C4C counselor and a firm advocate for computer science courses.
And I'm Tom Kyle, computer science teacher and firm advocate of engaging school counselors to build your CS program.
So we're going to be speaking to you today about how to engage some of our special needs students as we start looking at enrollment and registering students for classes. So C4C is a component of NCWIT. You'll receive this slide deck, and so you'll have a chance to go back through and look at some of the resources that C4C and NCWIT offers. So the Counselors for Computing program provides information and resources that help counselors join the front line of the computing conversation. One of the really cool things about C4C is that they do provide lots of free resources to counselors. And so feel free to reach out to them to ask for those materials. And when they have them, they will send them to you. The reason I say when they have them is because they go pretty quickly. So school counselors are in a unique position to work with students and removing barriers, and then also to work with many different stakeholders. And so one of the barriers that sometimes we have is for our special needs students.
Right. So talking about these barriers, there's all kinds of preconceived notions. Ordinarily, I'd give you more detail than this, but you can read the slide and see what we're talking about. There's lots of things that affect people's opinions about who could be a computer science student, when in reality, everyone can and should be. So let's talk about briefly, what is computer science? Computer science isn't just programming. It's just posing a problem in such a way that a computer can help us solve it. So you've got to be able to communicate, solve problems, design and imagine, and design a computing device and program. So a word from our special students. We're getting ready to play a couple videos for you where we show you an interview that we did with two of our students. And I say our because in both cases, they are my student in a computer science class, one or more, and they are both just happen to be students that fell in Ruth's alpha as a counselor. So they really are both of our students. One of the things that came up, we were talking about getting ready to interview these students as a team from C4C. Ruth and I and several other people were discussing, you know, what kind of special ed kids do we want to find, and should we not get some that are very well spoken and, you know, represent well? And I said, but wait a minute, we're talking about including special needs kids. Wouldn't it be better if the perceived disability was more obvious? One of the ones we chose is a gentleman with a pronounced stutter. Another student is fairly shy and doesn't speak a whole lot. It's like, you got to pull stuff out of it. Well, you'll see in the video, these students, to the rest of us, are easily recognizable as a potential special ed student. But their perspective was a little different. Let's take a look.
Hello, I'm Tom Kyle, and I'm here with one of my students, Edgar, talking about his challenges or lack thereof in my classroom. So Edgar, first, would you tell us a brief story about how you got involved in computer classes? What was the spark that got you started?
I believe it with technology started out since I was very little. I first had a computer in my room. Mm-hmm. And so I was playing, like, you know, I also played like flash games on there like every time because they were fun. And I remember during my freshman year, we got a paper to find out for our classes for next year as a sophomore. And two classes that interested me were PC maintenance and cybersecurity. Since the reason why those two classes interested me is because one, for me personally, I actually want to like know like that like the in and outs of a computer, so one day I can build them by myself. And just why I chose cybersecurity is because I'm interested into coding, and cybersecurity will give you that skill in the future.
Absolutely.
About who in the family you wanted to be like?
I'm
Brian
and William.
Yeah, so that's how you see it.
That
just
makes sense
out of that.
How do you like William and Uncle Brian?
Oh, so are they family members that are in?
Yeah.
In computing? So do you know anything about the things that they do? What's their job?
Like how they know computers?
Oh, very cool.
So is hi, everybody. My name is Mina. I'm a master's student studying computer science at Auburn, and I'm here to share my story with all of you. So I was born and raised in India, and somewhere at the age of 5 to 6, I was diagnosed with a speech impediment. Specifically I stutter, as you can see. And my childhood was, it was not the best childhood. Opportunities and confidence wise, I had a mix of like both good and bad teachers. I didn't have the best accommodating environment. I was always feeling that I'm just not on par of my friends, and I still remember the time when I think it was in my fifth or sixth grade, we used to like have these speech competitions back in school. And like the one of the teachers told me that I shouldn't participate in the speech competition because I took too long to speak. So yeah, so it was not the most accommodating environment back at home. My major starting in college was economics, but in my first year of my college, I like attended a coding class for just fun, and I just like loved the class so much that I like changed my major to computer science in my sophomore year. I think for me, programming, it came a way to express myself. I like still remember for one of the class projects, I made a bot which made the computer speak on behalf of me. So like it just like gave me so many new ways to express myself, and soared my confidence to a new level.
So Edgar, would you describe what you do with technology that makes you excited? What are your plans going forward?
My plan one day is to hopefully get a good job that was on with technology, words like, you know, coding or work with computers or something just related with technology in general. Because for me, I love video games, I love, you know, a lot of stuff about it, and hopefully one day I can land a career in that field.
Programming. I like the programming.
Really? You like the programming. So are you able to code?
Yeah.
What language are you able to code in?
In Java.
Can you tell me about any project that you've coded?
I'm making a solitaire program.
So the one of the turning point in my school was I got the Google Lime scholarship. It's a scholarship for students with disabilities who are computer science majors. I'm just going to Google, just seeing so many more disabled students who were studying computer science too. It was just fantastic. So I started to gain more and more confidence in my computer science skills. It like automatically gave me the courage and the strength to speak up and to share my story.
So Edgar, how has your disability affected you in tech classes? Tell us about your experience with that. And how do you handle social expectations? And related to that, what do you think educators need to know?
Well, first of all, for me personally, I don't think I actually have a disability. I just stuttered a bit, and other than that, I'm fine. So for me, I think it was people, I'm actually like, normal with it. I don't like, you know, I don't like overthink about it. So I just talk to people.
So you don't have a disability. We have a disability understanding. That's our problem, right?
Yeah. And if we're moving to questions, my like disability hasn't really like hindered me with your classes. I just worked it like normally.
Outstanding.
And some are like interviewed for a internship at Microsoft, and I got it, and be starting my full-time job there the next June. The year is wrong there. It should be 2021, not 2020. So the one of the things what helped me in my Microsoft interview was to ask for accommodations. So speaking for me, it's a very tiring job to do. So I can speak for Emacs of like say 40 to 50 minutes of without feeling too tired. So what I did was like ask them for accommodations where I could type instead of speak. So the interviewer could have a Google Doc at this front, and we both would type in the same doc, so they could see my responses at the same time. And that was the perfect solution for me. One of my favorite is that my disability like drives innovation. So whenever like trying to code or trying to make a product, I can think of it from the whole perspective that like, how do we make the product more accessible to everybody?
Edgar, how do you communicate with teachers or educators about your needs? And how would you like them to communicate with you about your accommodations?
Well, first of all, they talked to me about my disability, so the financial work. And second of all, if there's a student with, you know, with an actual like disability and they need like, you know, more attention, I think like, you know, teachers must like, you know a bit more about the disability and, you know, like a student in general.
Yeah, I think something to be aware of. Until you and I talked about it just a little while ago, I had more of a problem saying the word disability than you did. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's on me, because I should have had this conversation with you back at the beginning of the school year. But at the same time, to your credit, you walked in like you owned the place. You did not acknowledge that you needed any special attention. And, you know, my policy has always been I treat every kid the same. I have to go look at accommodations lists to even know who my special ed kids are, because they're often successful without any accommodations. So, you know, good on you for that. But I probably still should have that conversation with students just to make them feel more comfortable.
Exactly.
All right. Well, good. So, Edgar, how can teachers and school counselors and administrators support you as a student with a disability?
This is all I've got to say. And it's two factors. Number one, what kind of disability does it have? And two, the personal life of the student and how they're feeling. The reason why I say those things, because take me for example, my speech impediment may classify as a disability. However, me personally, I don't feel like it's a disability. If for me, that doesn't hinder me with interacting with other people. However, some other students might feel the opposite. And I say teachers need to keep that in mind for a student with disability. Some students, like, you know, don't feel they have one, or some others are, like, you know, hindered down because of their disability.
Okay, that's fair. Thank you.
And it was, what do you think a school counselor would have been able to help you with better?
Sure. So back in India, I don't think that we had school counselors per se, so we just had teachers. I think from a perspective of, like, what teachers would do better is that, and I'm not saying that all the teachers, like, are the same, just I think a few of them, like, as I shared an example of the speech competition and stuff, I was intentionally being excluded from those, and that was really affecting my confidence. I think if a teacher, they just, like, came up to me and just said that if you want, you can speak for 5 minutes. Can we do something to help you to, like, be more calm, or to just help your stress levels to be able to speak to a large audience. I think that would have, like, helped me so much.
Yeah. So being more of an advocate, being able to get in there, for the kiddo and saying, hey, why can't she participate? You know, what's up with that? How can we help? Okay.
Yeah, for sure.
That is something where I think you would find most school counselors would be in there going, what can we do? We're going to make this happen. So thank you.
Yeah, I think it's just the it just takes 2 seconds to ask what you need, and it makes you feel so valued, you know? Yeah.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
When it comes down to people with disabilities, let's try to see all of that from a holistic point of view. The holistic point of view is inclusion. The holistic point of view is for people with disabilities to really just feel that they can, they don't have to struggle, and that the society is just not very friendly for people with disabilities. It's difficult. I mean, every person with a disability has their own struggles. And every day, in some ways, for doing our daily life activities, we are reminded of that fact. And so the only thing that we kind of don't want is that when we go in settings such as in education, at work, in recreation, we don't feel the same there, because that's our outlet. That's where we don't want to look for those things. In our daily life, we are reminded of that every single second. When we wake up to the point we go to bed, there are things that happen during the day, of smaller things, even when we lift up a cup or put it down or talk to someone. When it comes down to counselors, and if I'm in school, then I'm just really looking for someone who understands me. I'm just really looking for someone who can really, I can just be myself with. I can go and tell them how I feel without being judged, without being, for it to be just a safe space. And I think for to achieve that, it's really important that all the counselors and educators and teachers are aware of what a disability means. That they have educated themselves to an extent where I can feel comfortable going to them and talking about my disability. So I don't have to tell them the struggles that I face.
That's why I was glad to hear you use the word spectrum. My youngest is on the autistic, is on the spectrum. And I really like it when people refer to it as it's a spectrum, because there are days where it's better for him than others. And so to me, that's part of the spectrum as well. It's kind of like us, we're all on a spectrum, because if I didn't have coffee, it would not be a good thing. So I think in a lot of ways, we're all on a spectrum. So and I know one of the things that frustrates me for him is when people hear, oh, he's autistic, so it's this, or he's autistic, so it, you know, here's his little box. And to remind us, we all have a box, if you want to look at it that way, but none of us wants to be a box. We all want to be, you know, a spectrum of a person. We have likes, we have dislikes, we have things we can do and things we can't do.
Absolutely, Ruth. And I'll just add to that, that when people look at disabilities, they usually look at permanent disabilities. They usually think of somebody in a wheelchair, or somebody who has mental health issues, or someone who is deaf or blind. But the truth is that people have different varying level of abilities. And sometimes that's situational. Sometimes that's temporary. For example, in temporary disability, you can imagine someone who's just broken their leg, they will be fine. But while during that time, they might be doing the exact same thing that a person with a permanent disability does. Then there are these things called situational disabilities. And that you can imagine, for example, a woman who's pregnant. You wouldn't expect a pregnant woman to climb up the stairs. So why do we not have elevators? Things like that. It gets to a point where you can think about people who live in cold weather, right? And they have to wear gloves all the time. So how are they going to use their phones? They can't. So this is where we start thinking about, okay, well, there's this thing called as text to speech. This is how that technology, you know, you start seeing that technology for all the different purposes. So there are sometimes, so for example, you can also imagine like the technology that now we have where we can kind of just speak to our phone without touching it, like Hey Siri, for example. We didn't have that before. We couldn't just say Hey Siri and Siri would just start listening. That didn't happen before. But that's also a situational disability in the sense that your hands might be, you might be cooking, your hands might be tied in something and you can't really, you know, do something, but you need your phone. So it's a really broad topic. And the way to look at it is sometimes people get into this the little box of thinking that disability is just, you know, not just that person in a wheelchair, that person with a cane, or that person who's deaf. But it's a little bit more than that. You know, it's just applies to everyone. So definitely a spectrum.
Yeah. Edgar, what advice would you give educators for working with a student with a disability like yours?
I say just be patient, because reason why, because some students are also looking, you know, because more time and attention than others. So, you know, a bit more patience with them.
Okay, we can do that. Well, thank you, Edgar. I really appreciate you taking time to talk to us today. And we look forward to seeing you in class next week.
What kind of help would you want from your teachers? What would, without having to ask, if teachers were just able to read your mind to know exactly what you needed, what kind of help would you want?
They make it fun.
Oh, you like when they, so do you find your programming class to be pretty fun?
Yeah.
So what is it like to be a student with a disability in CS? So I'm just going to share some of my experiences there, and I know Mina has shared some of hers. So first is I want to focus on the difficult part of it. The difficult part of it is just as somebody with a mobility disability, somebody who's in a wheelchair, campus accessibility is really, really important, right? So wherever you all are, whichever school you're in, it's important to kind of like start thinking about like, okay, well, how accessible are the classrooms? How accessible is the campus, right? Are people able to enter a classroom without having to be really hard to even push the door open? Are there push buttons there? Is there a ramp there? What about stairs? Are there stairs that block in their ways and things like that? So that's an important thing to consider. Then the note taking and typing, it's a very difficult task for somebody who has limited hand function. So it's important to think about those things as well. And most of those things are provided as an accommodation through the disability resources in your respective organization. But that's something as a counselor, as a teacher, to kind of keep an eye out for. What can we do to kind of identify the need for someone to do note taking and typing, and what can we do about them, and how can we redirect them to appropriate resources? I think that's really important. Now, the third part that is really difficult and that might not be evident is for somebody with a disability to have a constant feeling of proving themselves to others. And I think we kind of sense that in Mina's talk as well. And most people with disabilities go through that. They just feel like they have a need to constantly prove themselves to others. And that's a very unhealthy thing. And most of the times, even they don't know that they have to do that. They just are put into a society and in a situation where they just have to. So it's important as counselors and as teachers to recognize when those things are happening and give them the proper guidance, being there for them. It's really, really important, right? Because they might be struggling with things that you might not know, and they might not be something that they might not even know. So that's something to keep an eye out for and things that to consider. Accommodation processes, even though there are organizations such as like Office of Disabilities, disability offices, and whatever the name is at your respective organizations, they are a pain. It takes forever to get an accommodation set up. Even then, you have to provide documentation, you have to do all of those things. So it's important as counselors and teachers to kind of start thinking about those things. And
so isn't it interesting that neither one of these students felt like they had any significant issue? They both downplayed what we would classify as a disability, and certainly they qualify for the special ed program, but yet neither one of them saw their disability, if you will, as a problem. And in fact, most of the time they felt it was other people's problems to deal with them. And, you know, I think that's a great reality.
One of the interesting things that we managed to get during this is bonus audio from a parent. As the parent was trying to help us get her student to talk, I realized how much she had to say. And so we asked her if she minded if we used a few clips from what she had to say.
So what got Vincent involved in computer science in the first place? What got him to want to take that class?
Well, he's always had an interest in computers, just like most kids. But he wanted to be like his stepdad and his uncle, who are both into computers.
Okay.
So that's what made him interested. And then computer science has just really kind of been what is really appealing to him, the programming aspect of things. He's made one of his best buddies. They write programs together, so it's kind of given them.
Who's the best buddies?
Who's your best friend that you write programs? Steve. Yeah, he and his friend Steve write programs together and talk about it and stuff like that. So it's kind of helped him build a friendship.
That is amazing.
You got all that bonus video, students and parents, and we're just really excited about the way it turned out.
So here's the information you need to make sure school counselors have, that everyone is welcome, everyone is able. Now, there may be prerequisites. For example, with some classes, you may need to have taken algebra or a similar course. But as long as they are in the pathway, then they are a good candidate. I always say, how do you know what students to place in certain classes? And my response is always, if they go to your school, you need to consider placing them in classes.
Exactly. And guys, don't forget about middle schools. Those students are a treasure trove of fertile ground, because in middle school, you have very few elective choices. If you're not into music, athletics, or art, your choices are often very limited. And if you can get your school to extend your computer science program down into the middle school, you can go ahead and lock up some students and get their interest while there's not as much competing for their attention. And then by the time they hit high school, they already love computer science and they want to explore it further, and they're more likely to stick with it. Plus, in Texas at least, there are several courses they can take at the middle school level and get high school credit. So they've already got some credits toward graduation, which helps you when you want to try and give them that fourth year, but you've got seniors that are opting out early and that kind of thing.
Slide, there are some other resources. Again, you'll get this in the slide deck. There are also freebies that you can consider. There's some video links. And the Code magazine is a really good one to just have in your office. It's another one that's free. And just there's just so many resources from NCWIT and C4C.
Yeah, those have been embedded throughout the presentation. Anytime you see something like this, it's something for you to click on and see. There's free resources almost everywhere.
So here again is the NCWIT slide. Any of those links that you see throughout the video, as Tom said, you can click on them. You can find out more information. You can also reach out to us and contact us. We'll make sure that our contact information gets out there. And again, thank you for sitting in with us and having a chance to rethink how to include your special ed students in your programs.
One other thing I want to mention before I go. It has always been my opinion that students that have trouble communicating with their peers and with the outside world often communicate very well with a computer. So while you may have trouble communicating with them, you put them in front of a computer, they're comfortable because the computer doesn't have any expectations on how they're supposed to behave. It just meets them where they are. And many special ed students are more comfortable interfacing with a computer than with people. And you'll find those shy, quiet, hesitant students blossom and come alive and be extremely successful. So use this as an opportunity, not a, oh my goodness, here's another student I've got to deal with. These students could be some of your best students. Thank you all for attending, and we'll take some questions now.
Right, thank you so much, Tom and Ruth. A few things for our attendees. Not all of our panelists or interviewees that you saw throughout the recording were able to join us during this session. However, they will be joining us during some of the following sessions. So I do encourage you to go back onto our Advising for Future Ready Careers website and watch the recording in about a week to see if you get some further answers to any of your questions from some of the other panelists. Also, Tom and Ruth referred to some of the clickable links throughout their presentation. We will be also offering their slide deck with the pre-recording, with the recording on our landing page. So Ruth and Tom, if you'd like to join me, we have a couple questions here. We've got quite a few questions here. We'll try to get to as many as we can. So the first one that I have for you is, and Ruth, as a school counselor, I think maybe you might be able to take this first. What's your recommendation for helping students who may not have official documentation for their disability due to the lack of access to medical professionals?
Well, one of the things the school counselors do is often we have to make things as accessible as possible. So you may not have the documentation you need, But if you interact with that student and talk to them about some of their interests, then many times you can help them get the services they need. Often by helping them get the services they need, such as through enrolling them in certain classes or getting them that extra support, then you may be able to look at, okay, here's an extra support that we can give this student, but we just need to make sure that they're at school every day if possible, that they have interaction with the nurse. So there's a lot of times where we wear a lot of hats and we have to make some of those things happen.
Yeah, absolutely. I think even during my school counseling training, I found that those relationships with outside services have really helped in being able to talk with families and talk with the students about, hey, we may have identified a need that this student has, and we are actually able to provide the services that would get them all of the things that they need. So I agree, and I think that those relationships with outside services can often be helpful.
And a lot of times it's in your approach. If you tell a family you've got this wrong, then they're gonna, you know, kind of recoil. But if you tell them, hey, we know of this resource, is this something that you would be interested in? Is it something that you feel would be helpful to you? A lot of times it's all in the approach.
Yeah, and actually Aether spoke in the presentation, and something that he had shared was nothing about us without us, right? Mm-hmm. And this is what it speaks to what you were saying, and that you want to bring those parents in, the family in, and the student in, because the student is going to be able to, as long as we give them the voice, they're going to be able to tell us a little bit about what they need. Right. Tom, do you have anything that you'd want to add?
Well, I didn't hear 504 mentioned. Ruth, correct me if I'm wrong, but can't any student get some of the accommodations? You don't have to have a special ed diagnosis to get a lot of the accommodations that are available. Is that correct?
That is correct, but we still have to have parental consent to review some things that we think would be helpful. So even though special ed might not be the designation that a parent wants on their student, sometimes it's, again, education about what a 504 plan is and how that could be helpful. Some parents don't want their children, quote unquote, labeled. And so, again, educating, walking them through, offering it in a soft way, and getting those students the resources and the connections that they need.
Yeah. Tom, thank you.
Another thing I would mention, and I'm going a different direction here, but computer science has been shown to elevate test scores across the board. There seems to be a direct correlation between the problem-solving skills and other things you learn in computer science classes and your ability to score well in all subjects. This is something that should get administrators excited, because these state mandated tests are kind of the holy grail of education today, unfortunately, but that's the world we live in. But if you can, help your peer advocates within your organization lobby that, hey, computer science is going to help more than just the computer science class. It will help our students across the board be more successful if they've had these experiences.
Tom, that actually brings me into two of the other questions that I have for both of you is, your experiences with colleagues have you ever experienced a colleague saying that they didn't feel that computer science was for a student with a disability, or has it been difficult to get your colleagues on board for bringing in a student that may have a disability to their computer science classes?
Let's just say that not all teachers are created equal. Not everybody is enthusiastic about embracing what can amount to more work. I have a special ed background before I was teaching computer science classes. So I had a little bit different perspective. I wasn't, if you will, afraid to take a student who might be some of the more extreme diagnoses, if you will. But not all teachers have that attitude. And, some of them have had bad experiences that color their opinion. And, you have to approach those teachers where they are. You can't try and ram it down your throat. You can say, well, you know, but I've been really successful this way. Probably the best thing is, instead of asking them to take new students, find opportunities where they have existing students, whether they have any specific label or diagnosis or not. There are always challenging students. And if you can help that teacher do their job better by offering those kind of suggestions, you know, he's talking about a problem or she's talking about this problem child. You know, if you've had success working with that kind of a student, you know, say, well, you know, I tried this and it worked really well. And you know, it's less confrontational that way. And then once they understand that you can really reach every kid, it's all about your approach. You have to build a relationship. All of those things we learn in the seminars we go to really does make sense. And once you've built the trust with that teacher, then you can start to encourage them, hey, by the way, I think this student would be great in your class. When I had him, I had this experience. And they learn to trust you because they've seen it work in their own lives.
It's a constant circle of education, right? Educating our colleagues, educating our parents, educating ourselves. We don't have a lot of time, but I know that there's a lot of questions, and I even personally had to reach out to a colleague today with the question of language surrounding individuals with disabilities, how to either refer to their disability or to, I was writing their bios, how would I address the disability in their bio? And I was just wondering if very quickly you might be able to share any resources or even small anecdotes as to the best way to kind of navigate that language.
I think asking the student a number of times, you know, it's kind of like we do with our LGBTQ students. When we ask them, what pronouns would you like for me to use with you? I think it's the same, I think it's very similar in that, you know, how do you want me to refer to you? Okay, I want you to call me Edgar. Okay, I can work with that. So sometimes instead of seeing the child, we see the label first, when what we should be doing is seeing the child and not the label.
Now, it's pretty consistent with what my colleague had shared, that the person first language, and then, and like you said, then kind of refer back to what the student says. Tom, is there anything that you would want to share on that topic, Les?
No, that's exactly what I was going to say.
Perfect. I think that I'd like to start with a question that, Mina, you did start answering in the Q&A feature, but maybe you could go a little bit more about that, and then Tom and Ruth, you can weigh in also. But if we talk about language surrounding students with a disability, how do we destigmatize the language? How do we navigate how we talk to our students, how we describe their disability? Just share with us, what are some of the sources we could use or strategies?
Sure, yeah, I think the answer that I put in the chat, so in addition to that, sometimes we use a lot of words unknowingly, for example, you may say that I just like had such a crazy day. The word crazy is not an appropriate choice of word to use. So I just came across a very good article which like explained the negative connotations associated with these words. So I think we we need to be more careful about the language we use. Yeah.
Thank you. Well, first, I'd love for you to share that article, and maybe that's something that we'd be able to share with amongst our social networks. But that deliberate language, and then also thinking about what words we use and how we're using them even in our everyday language. Tom, Ruth, is there anything that you would like to add?
Well, I just, you know, that's not a word that I would think to worry about. The word crazy, I mean, and, you know, this has, you know, I'm approaching 60 years old in a few years, and only in the last decade have I really become aware of these kinds of issues, whether it's with disabled students or with minorities or whatever. I've been a white male my whole life, so my life has been pretty good as far as the kinds of challenges everyone else faces. And it's not that I'm insensitive, it's just I'm unaware. And the more we have these kind of conversations, the more we get people like me to understand it. I think that's the key to changing the world, is just getting people aware. You know, so many people, they blow it off. Well, that's just somebody else complaining. No, that's not it. They just want to be heard from an equal footing. And paying attention to the language we use is just a piece of that, but it's something that we can act on.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, and increasing that level of self-awareness and maybe how our words or our vocabulary may be impacting someone else, or maybe even what the definition, the real definition of a word, how that might impact any of our listeners when we're conversing. So thank you, Nina. That's a really great point. And I think this constant education circle, attending webinars like this, engaging in these conversations, is what's going to be able to make us more aware.
I think sometimes you have to just step in there and just ask people, what did they mean by that? When they say something, just say, so what exactly did you mean by that? And kind of make them, because sometimes people pop off and say things without realizing how insensitive or how rude it may come across. And so a lot of times just having people explain themselves, which sometimes they will, sometimes they won't, is an opportunity for you to say, well, now you know that you don't have this information, or you know that if you came at me that way, I, as a colleague, would not be okay with that. Why do you think a student is okay with that? So just, that's another way to advocate for our students.
Oh, absolutely. Asking those questions as a pushback, because our students might not have that voice. NCWIT actually has a resource called the Critical Listening Guide. And a lot of the conversations do surround around gender and sexuality. But I think some of the strategies that they have there, as far as challenging the person speaking that is saying things that might be hurtful or ignorant or misinformed, and asking questions like Ruth said, what do you mean by that? I think these are great strategies, great conversation. Thank you. I'm going to go to another question and kind of ask it separately. Tom and Ruth, as far as working with colleagues and bringing more students and diversity into computer science, have you ever come into a situation where a colleague is pushing back as far as whether or not computer science is appropriate for a student with a disability? And Mina, on the same side, have you experienced that, where teachers or educators have pushed back on you as to whether computer science was the right fit for you? Maybe Ruth or Tom, you could start.
Sure. Yes, I had this. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Sure. Again, sometimes just educating people get real comfortable with the way they are, and they don't want to change, and you're not going to make them change. And so sometimes you can only invite people to change. You can't make them change. And you can put the information out there, and it's up to people what they choose to do with it. ultimately, how you choose to help a student in a healthy way is between you and that student. And if that colleague is not going to be supportive, then sometimes all you can do is continue to educate, continue to invite. But we all know, being in school, if you wait for everybody to get on board, we're never going to get anywhere. So sometimes you just have to professionally put some distance and make sure that that person is in turn not damaging your student by some of the things they may say or do.
Yeah, absolutely. We just have to be those bulldozers sometimes and stick to what we know is right. Tom, did you have more to add to that?
Well, just real quick, the best strategy I have found to engage a teacher that doesn't want a special ed student is to find ways to be helpful to them. That does two things. One is, if you can help them handle a student they already have, and you listen, you know, teachers will complain to each other and they'll say things hoping to get reinforcement of their bad opinion. And if you approach it the right way and offer to help, don't dismiss them, because they're entitled to their own feelings, but offer to help and show them that there are actually productive ways to deal with people that have challenges and to help everyone learn from that, including the teacher. And the second part of that is that then builds a relationship with them, so that if you do have an opinion to offer them, they're more likely to hear it.
Absolutely, thank you. Mina, what about your experience? Have you ever received any pushback?
Sure, what I have faced a lot, I think it's just not at my teachers or just like anybody whom I go talk to. So like, I will share a small example. So I think 2 years back or something, I went to my school career fair to talk to companies like the jobs and for internships. So when I like started to talk to this company, they told me that they had no spots for computer science students left to interview. And I think and the way that I spoke to them, it was we are chatting. So and like I just like typed the message on my phone notes, and I just showed it to them. So after they told me no, it was, I think, just like 5 minutes later, and I saw another student asking the same question for interviewing for a computer science internship, and I saw them saying yeah, sure. So I still don't know what the reason was that they said no to me. I then think it's just seeing from their body language, like it was apparent that they didn't want me there. So I think that like we as human beings, we have this idea of like normal. So the people they consider normal are to be a fluent speaking person who does not stutter while they speak. Then if they see somebody who talks like me, they start to think, can't you really do the job? And they make a lot of assumptions. So I think we need to stop making these wrong assumptions and treat everybody the same.
Yeah, I can't imagine having to experience something like that. And I just, as we go on, it's a good thing that then you were able to completely switch and have Microsoft give you the accommodations that you needed to interview and make it, you didn't even need them. They could interview with you, but then they gave it something to you so that it would make it as accessible as possible for you by having you type with them, right?
Yeah.
And then now you have graduated, right, with your master's degree and will be starting as a software engineer with Microsoft.
Yeah, so I think when I first saw the interview mail from Microsoft, they the line and the email saying if you need accommodations, please apply to us. So I think like the first time, like I'd like seen such a mail, but I didn't feel the need to like to ask them myself. They asked me if I do need accommodations to do my job more better. Then that made my interview process so much more smoother, because instead of like getting stressed out about my speech, I could focus on the content of the interview.
Absolutely. And I mean, the real winners in this is Microsoft, because now they have another perspective on their team, and it's in their best interest to be offering those things to you, as opposed to you as a person having to come to them and say, make your interview process more accessible. So congratulations. With some of the questions that have been answered in the chat already, I wanted to see if we could talk about accommodations. So Mina talks about her success story with Microsoft, but in the previous session, we've also heard a not so great story about accommodations. And Aether talks about, in his portion of the presentation, about what accommodations look like. So how can we educate our students about the accommodations that are available both in their high school and middle school years, as well as post-secondary? What's available to them, what they're able to ask for. Yeah, who would want to start off on that subject? Maybe Ruth, you could talk about kind of that accommodations process from a school counselor standpoint.
I'm sorry, you're gonna have to repeat the question because I was trying to answer a question in the Q&A.
Oh, no problem.
Go ahead, repeat the question.
Yeah, sure. So I was just asking about the accommodations process as far as how do we educate our students about them? How do we, while they're in high school and middle school and elementary school, but then also how do we educate them about accommodations that could be available that they can ask for once they're in post-secondary?
Many times it's about empowering the student to reach out for themselves. I remember doing the STAR testing, which if anybody's from Texas, they know about STAR, but I remember doing a testing with a student and she was supposed to get an accommodation. We didn't know about it because we didn't have all her records. And she came to me and she said, I'm supposed to get this accommodation and this accommodation, and this accommodation. And I told her, good for you. And so we had to sit down, do some record searching, call another school. But I told, so I said all that to say, sometimes we have to teach kids, this is what you're due. So if you're not getting those things, approach the teacher. And if the teacher's not hearing you, come to your counselor. And if we can't solve it, we'll take it a step further. So just helping those students advocate for themselves.
Mina, what are your thoughts on that, that self-advocating from a student perspective?
Sure. I think the one thing which like really helped me is some of the external resources. So I think on my sophomore year, I was introduced to Access Computing. It's I will share the link later, but it's a organization for high school students and the college students who have disabilities in the computing field. So and like the one of the main advantages of that organization is that they have a student mailing list. So we all we have blind students, and some deaf students, and we all talked about accommodations there. I think, I just like speaking to people, who are in the same position as you, it is so very helpful. And I think finding that the community of support was so helpful to me.
Yeah, that is a community and having those different perspectives. That's probably one of the best ways to solve any problem, right? Yeah. So it's great that you're able to self-advocate and then that we have school counselors like Ruth that are able to provide the resources that the students need to know what accommodations are available. But then what if we shift to the teacher perspective? Tom, when you have a class of a lot of students and you might have a lot of accommodations to pay attention to, what are some of the best ways that you're able to be successful in that classroom? How are you able to best serve those students? How are you best able to be aware of the accommodations needed? Oh, you're muted.
How about that? As teachers, one of the things you learn early on is you have to have relationships with your students. You cannot teach in a vacuum. And that will help you with classroom management and all kinds of other things. But it will also help you with accommodations, because those students that are reluctant to ask will be more comfortable asking if they know you and they know you care. You get lists of accommodations, and these are things that are available to the students, but it doesn't mean that every student needs every accommodation every day. So, you know, it's just like parenting. You know, there's no manual that says this is how you raise a kid. You have to learn it as you go. Mm-hmm. And so that it means being involved in what the kids are involved in. And that doesn't mean I can go to every extracurricular activity that every student does, but it means paying attention, you know, noticing if they come in the door and they're not their normal cheery self. What's going on today? You know, maybe they're having a rough day. They're going to need an accommodation. You know, they may need, you know, some kids have built-in timeouts and things like that. But it's that awareness. It's not, okay, I've got this tool belt and I'm going to throw things at kids until I see the one that helps them. And it's more about understanding the kids' needs from a human perspective, and the accommodations. Those are just tools that you use when you solve the real problems that the kids have.
Yeah, I really like that. I think we've had a theme of talking about continuing education and self-awareness, and then also the relationship with students. To share my own experience with interviewing Vincent, I was only with him for maybe 15, 20 minutes on that call. I did not know what maybe disability he might have. I was not aware of what it may be. And I had to make sure that I was really self-aware of noticing how he was responding. And I realized very quickly, I'm using too many words and it's making him uncomfortable. And if I slow down my questions, then that will make him more comfortable and open up to me. So I think that self-awareness piece, like you said, is, and building that relationship is what's going to help those students open up and be able to cater to them the best. One of the questions in the Q&A was about what educators could do starting tomorrow. And Mina, I saw that you responded, and Ruth, you responded, but is there any more that you would like to share?
I think sometimes we go to workshops and we hear all these wonderful things and we think, oh, that is so cool. And then the next day life goes back to normal. So I think I like what they said about what's one thing. And I think if you pick that one thing, because often we want to try to do 15 things at once because they all sound fabulous. Pick that one thing and hammer away at that one thing, and then it will eventually grow into something bigger. So whatever it is, such as I think I mentioned Hour of Code, if that's that one thing, do that one thing. If there's an app your kids can download, then have them download that app, and that's that one thing. So you have to start somewhere, and sometimes it takes just one thing.
And Mina, do you have anything to add?
I don't think so. I think whatever Ruth said, I think it was on point. Yeah, I think I said this like in my last presentation to just asking the students of like what can I do to make your learning a more better experience? It doesn't take too much time to ask that, and I think I like also mentioned this the last time I was supposed to do
it. think that her screen may have frozen for a moment.
Can I pop in for just a minute then? Yeah. Until she, I like what she had to say about how can I make your learning a better experience. I just like the way that you put that, Mina, with how can I make your learning a better experience? Yeah, I like that.
Sorry, it's my Wi-Fi just stopped for a second. And sorry about that.
That's okay. Did you have anything else that you were you to finish up your answer?
I don't think so yet. I think, thank you. Sorry about that.
No, that's perfectly okay. And then my final question was just about engaging students in computer science. Maybe Mina, you could share quickly, you talked about what a success it was and how it built your confidence just being brought into a computer science club when you were in undergrad, but what was it that even made you go join that?
Sure, I think it was, it's a kind of a funny story. So when I was, trying to see the majors and everything, and the classes offered for every major, I think computer science was the one of the few majors that didn't have so many speaking classes. The the mandatory communication courses. So I think that just made me think it sounds like a good major, because I don't have to talk much in these classes. So I think that was the first spark. And then I attended some workshops and I just started to really like it. And as I gained more and more strength in my CS skills and all, the confidence, it automatically transferred to my speaking too. So
I really like that story. I've heard some of it before. You've shared that with us in another conversation, but so I really like that story. We are running out of time, but I did quickly want to address one of the questions about prerequisites in students with disabilities who may have difficulties in other academic classes. And at NCUIT-C4C, one of our favorite things to, we have some immediate challenges that educators can take to make computer science more and computing careers more accessible. And one of them is to advocate for there to be no prerequisites for your computer science courses. And I don't wanna put words into Tom and Ruth's mouth, but I think that you both would agree with that, that that makes them more accessible and those students usually still excel. Would you say that or no?
Yes, and that's actually something that I'm learning rather slowly. And it's that constant struggle. If you can have a prerequisite and you can get a whole bunch of kids that are in the same place, you can move faster through the material. But that kind of leads us back into the elitism that got us where we are today. If we really do want to reach every kid, if I really believe that everyone can learn computer science and that every kid should be in my class, then I need to welcome every kid in my class, regardless of prerequisites. Now, I think there are some obvious cases. You can't take advanced computer science until you've had the beginning class. You really need to know something about a language before you go into the deeper details. But the first class, the more entry points you can have into your program, the more classes don't have, we need to be looking for ways to eliminate prerequisites rather than add them. And you get the kid in, you meet them where they're at, you teach them what you can. And if they love it, they'll take another class. Maybe they have to take that class over again. Maybe they take it with a different teacher.
Right.
Before they move on to the next one so that they're comfortable. That's okay. Because the point is we're trying to teach the kids. We're not, you know, we're fortunate that this subject isn't state tested. So we don't have to meet some rigorous, every kid must succeed at this level or your program's a failure. So let's teach all of them. And it does make it more challenging on the teacher, but that's okay. We can handle it.
We can handle it. One of my favorite stories about a student getting kind of involved in computer science was they couldn't spell the word restaurant. So what they did is they put a macro on their Google Docs and on their Word documents. So that way they knew they always spelled it one way. So if the program picked up that they spelled it that way, it would automatically fix it for them. And I mean, now we have Grammarly and everything, but it was such a smart thing to do. And it's like, you're losing points for misspelling, but then you make the computer help you with it. And we need those different perspectives in our courses. So we should have those students that are struggling in other academic areas. But anyways, thank you all so much. Oh, Tom, did you have one more thing to say?
Yeah, let me flip that around too. Computer science will help your algebra. Because you use algebra, so many math, I don't know about every subject, but so many students that struggle with math, it's because they can't relate it to real life. But if they fall in love with computers and they want to program a computer, you've got to understand basic algebra because computers, if you will, think algebraically. Those rules, those hard and fast rules that you have to do math, also apply in computers directly. So that's an angle to help. I mean, we've got all kinds of how to use computer science to teach algebra, to teach science, to teach all these other subjects. And that's another way to sell it is, you know, your algebra teacher ought to be sending you their struggling students to say, hey, can you help me reach these kids and show them why they need to know this stuff?
Right. A different way to engage the students in something that they're looking at it one way and you flip it around and they're like, oh, I get it now. I get the problem solving here.
Well, and if they're motivated, they're more willing to learn. Plain and simple.
Coming straight from a great teacher, an award-winning educator. Hey, attendees, thank you so much for joining us. I would encourage you again to visit our landing page, Advising for Future Ready Careers, so that way you can see our recordings and even some of our previous episodes. We would like to invite you to the June and July Advising for Future Ready Careers webinar. Registration is not yet open. So if you complete the form in the chat, I will personally invite you to these upcoming webinars. And this is also, filling out that form is a way for you to continue to receive updates from NCWIT C4C. In the next 2 days, look out for a survey in your email to receive your $25 gift card and your resource kit. And we thank you so much for your responses and for joining us, and see you next month. Bye.